very much for coming out here tonight, and this is a topic that, like I said when I started, is very topical right now, because right now is when we shape the battlefield for what healthcare is going to look like under the Trump administration. And I can tell you right now, we're working with a lot of people in this room. I'm working with them to help shape the battlefield, so to speak, for that discussion. Now, President-elect Trump has already highlighted a couple of key points that he wants to carry forward coming into the healthcare discussion going forward. Things like making sure that kids can stay on their mom and dad's policy up until 26, and things about purchasing policies across state lines. We're going to go off and help, stay true to some of the things that he's obligated or promised during the campaign. But there's a lot of other areas that we'd really like to see some improvements, and you're going to hear about those areas tonight in our discussion. Remember this monstrosity? How many of you guys have seen this before? This was put together by the time, at the time, it was Senator Sam Brownback of Kansas and Representative Kevin Brady of Texas. This is actually not just simply a color blot test for people that are colorblind. It actually is a functional diagram of how the Affordable Care Act works. All right? There's 159 new organizations created in the Affordable Care Act between a doctor and a patient. Each one of these dots corresponds to a section in this bad boy here, which is the actual printout of the Affordable Care Act. I'm one of the few oddballs that actually went off and read that act. And as Steve so sagely pointed out, it is about control. It has nothing to do about care. So the topic of tonight is to talk about how to cut those strings of control and exploit what we've identified as a couple free market loopholes to actually get people the care that they deserve at an affordable price. All right? So I'm going to try to put this in context of what it means to the state, just so you guys know why this is important. This isn't just important to individual policyholders, individual employers. This is important across the board to us as a state. How many limited government folks are in the room here? Yeah. Well, one way of being a limited government is to address some of the policies we're talking about here. How many people want to see some more job growth here in the state of Michigan? That's one of the keys in here as well. So there's a lot of things. I've got some papers, white papers out in the back there, or our editorials about how I view healthcare, and in particular direct primary care, as government Swiss Army knife, because it solves so many of the problems that we face. Everything from liabilities on the back end for post-employment benefits for retirees, to the cost of government now. What if you can actually provide better care to people for less money? What a concept, right? That's what the promise of tonight is all about. We don't have to settle with premiums increasing 30%. We don't have to settle with premiums increasing 110, 150% in some cases. There are better ways to go off and do this, and we're going to talk about that. So let's talk about from a perspective of private employers. First of all, how many people here are actual employers that are interested in hearing more about healthcare options for their employees? Okay, so we've got a couple. How many here are doctors that are interested in seeing what options are available? Okay, got a few more doctors. And how many people are just individuals that are looking for options on how to save money for their own health care and improve the quality? All right, so that's the majority of folks that are interested to see what's going on there. Well, I'm going to start with employers, and we're going to talk about one of the things that we're looking at is that every year Michigan employers spend about $31 billion a year on healthcare. There's 10 million citizens on it. We got a potential saving if we adopt the practices we're talking about today of saving employers across the board about $6 billion a year. Now, what do you think that's going to do to job growth in the state of Michigan? If they can save money on benefits for employees and actually provide them with better benefits in the process, Michigan becomes the center of what we like to refer to as a free market healthcare revolution. That's huge. You know that bridge we've got over to Canada? Wouldn't it be nice to have all those single-payer folks coming on over to here and taking advantage of our healthcare system? All right, for public employees. We have 51,000 state employees. We spend about $664 million annually on healthcare for those employees. For local employees, so we're talking about townships, cities, municipalities, county employees, we got about $775 million spent annually. We could potentially save almost $300 million a year for for local units of government, which means more police officers, more firefighters, more teachers, more county road pothole fixers and all that kind of stuff across the board here to help us with stretching our dollars. And we don't have to save money, but the way you save money is by getting them better care and lowering the cost of health care. So let's look at Medicaid in particular. This is a passion of mine. Medicaid budget is the single largest line item in our budget right now. It's $17.5 billion, thank you, Medicaid expansion. If you were to go off and shave 20% off of a $17.5 billion budget item, we're talking $3.5 billion. That's a significant chunk of change, and about 40% of that are state funds. That can open up the door. So when you hear me say we don't have to raise taxes for roads, this is partly where I'm coming from. Let's use the money we have and spend it more wisely. And oh, by the way, get the people on Medicaid. If you're concerned about their care, get them better care. Right now, Medicaid does not provide good care. Patients or doctors or the care providers get 47 cents on the dollar. We need to make sure that they get good quality care, and you get that, you get rid of the scarlet M when you go off and provide direct primary care services, which we're going to talk about tonight. So it's higher quality, truly patient-focused care, and you can actually improve how we offer health care out to our citizens. So the next thing, so this is the audience we're looking for. We're trying to bring everybody together. So if you know of employers or doctors that might be interested in this later, there's a sheet out in back. Contact our office. We'll start up another health care. The goal is to be free market evangelists and bring people together and let them know what their options are. Here's all the different plan options that we have today. I'm not going to go into too much detail on this, but suffice it to say, you can either have a qualified health plan, which means that you have a health plan that meets all the requirements of this bad boy and keeps a IRS agent from knocking on your door, or you have Medicaid, Medicare, or you're one of the exempt organizations like a Christian Medicare, Medishare organization or healthcare ministry, and you've also got going off book into the open market. Everything used to be open market pre-1960, so, all right. And today, the way we're structuring our presentation is essentially we're gonna have Dr. Savage talk about primary care options and specifically his direct primary care practice. And we've got another direct primary care physician in the audience, at least one, and probably a few budding others. And so we're gonna divide up the total. Whenever you're talking about healthcare, we're dividing it into two different buckets. One is primary care, the other is catastrophic care. Catastrophic care is when things go bump in the night, you get hit by a beer truck or something, you have to go to the hospital. All right. Primary care is a day-to-day operation. I mean, you know, where you go off and you get your medical, your health, your physical, and all that kind of stuff. That's kind of the blocking and tackling. It's a good way of differentiating. The way Chad likes to talk about it is, one is you're going to get your car tuned up and you're getting the oil changed. The other one is, oops, you got into an accident, you got to go take it to a collision shop to go off and get it fixed. Does that make sense? So that's how we're structuring the presentation today. And what we're going to talk about is how to exploit some free market loopholes in the primary care side and how to extrapolate it into the catastrophic care side. Make sense? All right, if you need to contact us, there's some sheets out in the back there and you can plug in and get everything you need from us. So
in the next 20 minutes, I'd like to go over three main things. I will tell you, Steve did actually a fantastic job. Steve, are you in healthcare at all or no?
No, I just need it.
Okay, well, he did a wonderful job of explaining what's going on. That said, I'm going to take a couple of moments to kind of talk about, you know, what's going on in healthcare, where are we today, what direct primary care is, and then a little bit about how it works with various coverage options. And Tammy from MediShare will probably be very thrilled to know that actually I talk about MediShare a little bit too. So to begin with, you know, the current system, what's wrong with it, right? What's wrong with the insurance-based system? You know, let's start with a quick question. What should the practice of medicine look like? Well, in the practice of medicine today, physicians are overworked. Well, that's okay, right? They're rich, high-paid people. That's okay to work them real hard. But when the physician is overworked, what that results in, unfortunately, is really long wait times to see your doctor. The average wait time in the United States today is 19.5 days from the time you call to see your primary care doctor. It's a little better in Michigan. It's about 14. So it's only 2 weeks instead of 3 weeks, which is a real problem if you're sick and need to get in to see your doctor. And the sad truth about that is after all that waiting, you get to wait some more. They've actually shown that the average person must dedicate more than 3 hours of their day anytime that they see a doctor. And that's something called opportunity cost. It's the value of your time. I would assume that most of you have better things to do than to sit around in our waiting rooms. I mean, I'll admit it, mine's really nice. I got these little TVs and everything, but I'm sure you'd rather be spending time at work or with your family or doing something else. In fact, they've shown we blow $52 billion a year in lost opportunity costs, time waiting around in doctor's offices. Now, 3 weeks to get in, 3 hours waiting to see the doctor, including drive time, waiting in the exam room for the doctor, checkup time, 3 hours total, and you're graced with 8 minutes to see the doctor. And unfortunately, it's worse than that. The doctors tend to be very distracted. Recent studies have suggested that only 20% of a doctor's time is spent meaningfully interacting with a patient. 40% of their time is spent documenting that 20%. So they spend twice as much time documenting, talking to you and interacting with you as actually talking to you and interacting with you. But unfortunately, it's actually worse than that. They're also placed at conflicts of interest. Some of the new payment models that have been developed in the United States, things with incredible misnomers like pay for performance. It sounds great, right? Who thinks that, you know, everybody thinks a doctor who does a good job should be paid more. But performance according to who? According to you? The sad answer is no, it's not. It's according to the insurance company and the government. And what they deem good may not be what you deem good. For example, there's something called high-tech utilization ratings. This looks at how many MRIs a doctor orders. And if they order too many, they can be financially penalized for ordering them. So irrespective of whether or not that was the right test to order or not, if you come in and you have a knee injury and you think you need an MRI of your knee, your doctor may be put at financial interest with actually ordering that MRI, irrespective of if it's the right thing to do or not. And this is why this has occurred. So this graph most succinctly demonstrates what has occurred in the United States of any graph I've ever seen. Now ironically, though Obamacare has made things dramatically worse, the problems didn't originate with Obamacare. To explain this, this starts in 1970 and goes to just shy of 2010, 2009. The brown down here is the supply of doctors in the United States. And as you can see, over time it's been relatively flat. It's a slight upslope, slight increase in supply of doctors, not quite keeping pace with the population. The yellow is the number of healthcare administrators in the United States over that same time frame. And as you can see, there has been a veritable explosion of administrative burden, which is essentially bureaucracy. So don't buy the fallacy that doctors are driving up costs. Because if you watch the black line here, that's per capita spending. It's much more closely tracking with the administrative burden than the doctor supply. So much that in 2010, according to the U.S. Department of Labor and Statistics, 4.5 million Americans' job title were healthcare administrators, and there were 700,000 practicing physicians at that time. So 4.5 million people administering 700,000. And what does this feel like? The sad truth is this is what this translates into. The 800-pound gorilla that accompanies that doctor to every patient, every day, every visit, and if you notice, he's got the piggy bank here, right? And with that piggy bank, invisible strings control that doctor. They can tell them how fast to go, how many patients they need to see, what they can do, even the treatments that patient or that doctor actually can determine for the. So the doctor's almost meaningless here. You know, we train them many times for 12 years if you throw in residency and everything in undergrad, almost 12 years. Well, it's all cookbook, it's all algorithm based now. Now I wouldn't bring up a problem unless I thought there was a solution. And at least part of that solution, I believe, is direct primary care. So what is direct primary care? In direct primary care, the doctor works directly for the patient in a low-cost membership model of care, not the fee-for-service. You come in every time, you pay the doctor, and I'll get back to why that's important to get away from that in just a moment. Again, the doctor works directly for the patient. Why is this good? Remember all that yellow? When you bypass the yellow, you get rid of a lot of those misincentives and the costs that have been injected into the system. So there's no billing hassles. You get rid of the conflicts of interest. Most doctors do this in a wrap price, meaning for that low-cost monthly membership, it's all the primary care services that you can eat, everything that doctor does. Most of them have limited patient sizes. When I was an insurance company doctor about a year and a half ago, I had 3,500 patients assigned to me. That is ridiculous. You cannot give good care to that many people, and the only way you can even manage that many people is by having numerous roadblocks between you and that person. The receptionist, and then the triage nurse, and then the MA, and then maybe eventually the question gets to the doctor. In direct primary care, because it's limited to a small subsection of patients, those patients can contact us directly. They have our cell phone numbers, they have our email, and we can do this at an incredible price. It means improved accessibility. Why is it 19.5 days to get in to see your doctor? Because when you have 3,500 patients, you can only see so many people a day. When you're a saturated schedule every day, basically the person who gets the care is a person who's willing to wait the longest to access it. It's called time ration. People go, I want to see my doctor, I'm sick. Oh, 2-3 weeks, forget. Well, that means people drop out of care. It results in extended visits. No longer do you get the 8-minute rush visit. We schedule in 30-minute, 1-hour blocks, and that's basically the norm for direct primary care. And it's patient-centered. Those of you who are familiar with healthcare policy in the United States may have heard the term patient-centered medical home. Sounds great. Except once you get past the nice name, it's not patient-centered. It's all payment-centered. It's all based on various formulas to modify that doctor's behavior. And it allows for innovative delivery systems. I didn't bring it today, but I usually bring along with me the CPT coding rules. These are the rules through which doctors bill and code in the United States. And they actually mandate, essentially, for that doctor to be paid, you have to be physically face-to-face with them. Well, there's amazing technology that's available today, and though sure, that face-to-face visit is still needed in a lot of cases, there is a lot of medical management that can be done at your convenience, in your home, at your work, remotely through technology. The CPT coding has really not even yet recognized the advent of the telephone. This is not, I think Graham Bell would argue, this is not a new development. So what does a membership model look like? Well, as I mentioned, it includes all your office visits. For the low-cost monthly membership, you can see the doctor as much as you need. There are no co-pays, no additional fees. You can see that physician as much as you need. And why is this important? Well, studies have clearly shown that when the patient bears more of the financial burden every time they come to see their doctor, guess what they do? They don't see them as much. Now, that sounds great from trying to save money on the utilization of primary care doctors. If you look at it in isolation, that makes sense. And then, but until you look over and see what that does to hospitalization. When you decrease the utilization and decrease the costs on the primary care side, you double that savings in increased costs of hospitalization. Meaning that people are so scared to see their doctor that when they do come in to see their doctor, they're in a more advanced state of illness, they're harder to treat, more of them end up in the hospital. That's penny wise, pound foolish. It's a terrible thing for the money counters. But the real tragedy here is that the thing that's missed is that is a human toll. Those are people who are getting sick, and some people die because they don't utilize doctors in a timely fashion. The beauty of direct primary care, you don't have that disincentive. You've already paid for that doctor's time, so you can come and use and see them. So if you wake up in the morning and go, oh gosh, I don't feel so good today. Gosh, you know, I should go see my, wait a second, it's $140 if I go in there, and then he's only gonna order these EKG, and it's probably another $50. Nope, under this model, come and see him. You're not worried about it. Use them appropriately. It includes all in-office diagnostic tests. So if you need to do an EKG on you, you came in, you had some chest discomfort, great. It's included. You don't have to be worried about it. We need to do a spirometry, a pulse oximetry, a strep test, a mono spot. All of that stuff is included in that wrap price. When you buy a hamburger, McDonald's doesn't charge you more for the napkins. That's a wrap price. It's wrapped into the price of the hamburger. Well, if McDonald's can do it, why can't we? It includes all in-office procedures. Basic biopsies, basic joint injections, cryotherapy, wart removal, ear lavage, the things your primary care doctor would normally do, but is forced through the current system to nickel and dime and charge more for, we just wrap it into the entire price so you don't even have to worry about it. And this is the most significant thing. It allows for telemedicine, something that I think is more aptly called virtual home visits, meaning, again, you can access technology. If it's something basic that can be handled through a phone or an email or text message, why not use it? So what does that look like? So imagine you wake up on a Saturday morning and you've got this itchy rash and you were in the garden yesterday and you think, oh gosh, this is terrible. I saw the poison ivy there, but you know, I thought I stayed away from it. Well, I guess I didn't. You know, I'll wait until Monday and I'll see my insurance-based doctor. And oh wait, I heard it's 19.5 days to get in there. Oh gosh, I'll be lucky to get in this week. This is driving me nuts. I'm just going to the ER. Under this model, forget about it. You pull out your cell phone, right? You can't see it, it didn't come up. Take a picture of it. Text it to your direct primary care doc. Hey doc, got this itchy rash in the garden yesterday. Think it could be poison ivy? Why yes, that does look like poison ivy. Let me send some triamcinolone cream in for you. Let me know if you don't feel better. Quick, easy, convenient. Great for you. Timely, efficient, fast, wonderful. Great for the doctor. Our system, one of the systems, actually captures all this in real time in our record system. Wonderful, we don't have to double document. But you know who else it's great for? It's great for the sick person who was going to come in on Monday, who was just discharged from the hospital after heart failure, who needed a little extra time. And now your doctor's not spending time on something that easily could have been handled in a text message. They're able to allocate more of their precious time resource to that patient to more adequately manage them. So it's the beauty of giving the doctor the flexibility to be a doctor. And then we couple this to try to make sure we give people really good prices. So that's kind of what we do in the office. But then to make this as cost-effective as possible, we've maximized our medical degrees to get you great discounts on cardiac diagnostics, imaging tests, laboratories, generic medications, vitamins, and OTC medications. Well, let me give you some examples of this. So in the state of Michigan, the MRI is billed for $3,500. We are able to get them for as low as $240 now. I'm going to have to update this slide. That's a savings of over $3,000 on one test. In fact, my sister had an MRI not too terribly long ago, and she called me up, and she said, oh, thank God I have insurance. I said, why? And she goes, that test was going to be $3,500. I only paid $1,200. I said, Kelly, I could have got it for you for under $300. At that time, she said she'd drive across the state and repeat it. I don't know what's going on with that. My brother-in-law's here, so I'll have to pick on him later. So you can get echo stresses. This is a quality imaging-based stress test. They bill out at $1,100 to $3,000. We're able to get them for $207. That's a savings of $1,800 on one test. Just to put this into perspective, the savings you get on any of these studies, one of them would pay for unlimited primary care for a magnitude of years. That's how much we waste on this stuff. Chest x-rays bill at $260 to $460. We're able to get them as low as $33. That's a savings of $27. Diabetic testing supplies. Sorry, it got away from you guys. Diabetic testing supplies. I wanted to find out and be rational, get from people how much this stuff actually costs. About $100 for the Walgreens generic monitor with 100 strips. We're able to get True Metrics, which is a name brand, with 100 test strips for $18. That's a savings of over $80 a month. Medications, gabapentin, that's a nerve pain drug, helps with mood stabilization and other things. $130, we're able to get it for $4.37 for a month. That's a savings of $125 on one thing. And then labs, CBC, that's white cells, your immune cells, hemoglobin, hematocrit, that determines things like anemia, platelets, which are your clotting cells. Bills at $85. We're able to get it for $3.13. That's a savings of $81 on one test. So just to show you quickly, and I know I'm running fast on my time, so these are some of the prices we're able to get on things. We can get Zocor, a month of Zocor, cholesterol drug, for 72 cents. We can get flu shots for $9.99. We can get a month of Norvasc, which is a blood pressure med, for 51 cents. Z-Pax antibiotics for $2. Prozac, a month of that, 66 cents. And Zestrel, a blood pressure medication, for 39 cents a month. And we distribute it to the patient at that price. So how much does this cost? The price is right here, right? How much would a membership like that, all your visits, all the technology, all the in-office procedures, discounts, everything, what would a membership like that cost?
$157 a month.
$57 a month?
$157.
Just a little bit better than that. Starts as low as $39 a month. So now people say, well, how can you do it at that price? So I'd like to describe for you quickly for the doctors in the room something I call DPC math. When a doctor bills a dollar, they do not collect the dollar. The collection rate is about 60% on average for most practices in the United States. It means of that original dollar, and understand that's before the insurance company took their chunk, this is the dollar that actually is being charged by the office, he only collects 60 cents. But collecting that 60 cents was not free. It takes about another 40% of that residual to pay for the billers and coders and all the bureaucrats to collect the 60 cents, which means by the time you're all done, they're only left with 36 cents out of the original dollar bill. In direct primary care, you charge a dollar and you collect essentially a dollar. When the billing and collection of that dollar is the credit card transaction fee, which is about 2%, so you end up collecting 98 cents on the dollar. You collect three times as much of the original dollar charge. That means more dollars going to actual care, less going to bureaucracy and waste. So direct primary care works extremely well with low-cost, high-deductible PPOs, with the non-traditional Christian health sharing options, and ERISA-based plans. And I won't cover those in depth. But I want to give you an example. So Bob, I'm going to just show you his yearly cost. Bob's a great guy, 58-year-old diabetic. I want to show you all the cost of his care over the course of the year. So all his visits, all the labs, all the meds, what we can get him for. So if this is what you bill in an insurance practice, this is what we're able to get him the same services for. His annual labs, $56. We're able to get him for $23. All his visits, they're all included, right, direct primary care? That would have cost the guy who comes in four times a year $560. They're all included. Quarterly labs for diabetes, $515. We're able to get them for $34. There's something that's called draw fees. Every time you draw your blood, they charge you $23. We don't charge him for that. All his meds. He pays $115 for lisinopril. We're able to get him a whole year for $4.69. I'm just going to go through this quickly because, again, I don't want to run over these other speakers. But at the end of the year, if he used an insurance model, he would pay over $5,200 through the insurance company charged fees, whereas we can get him those exact same service with better quality of care for $832, including stress tests, chest x-rays. If I could go in detail, you'd see we have a lot that we did for this gentleman in this example. So what does this look like with various insurance products? So I went on to ehealthinsurance.com and I got actual quotes for this gentleman. For a 58-year-old guy who gets a platinum plan with Blue Cross Blue Shield, his premium, this is premium, he hasn't even seen the doctor yet, this is just what he pays the insurance company, is over $14,000 in 2016 and it's going to be higher next year. Now he pays all this money to try to save money when he actually sees the doctor, and he does, he only pays 10%, 10% of a false bill. Remember, it was over $5,000. It didn't cost that much to give his care. So he spends about 10% of over $5,000. He still ends up paying $540. Now he's smart now. He goes, well, that's a waste of money. I'm just going to get a high deductible by itself. Well, he saves $8,000 on his premium there. Good, smart option. Problem is, when he actually utilizes care, he is largely paying cash for his care. I tried to be as honest as possible. I knocked out the wellness visit and the wellness labs, your one time a year draw and visit to save you money. But he still ends up paying about $4,600 on top of that. So what if he does two things? He takes an inexpensive or less expensive insurance product, none of them are expensive anymore, and he matches that with the good pricing getting direct primary care. He gets the $8,000 savings here, but only pays $800 on top of that savings. And this is the real beauty. He goes and sees someone like Tammy and he gets a product like MediShare, Christian-based health sharing. The best kept secret in medical finance are the Christian health sharing products. There's four majors: MediShare, Liberty, Samaritan, and Christian Healthcare Ministries. All of them are incredible. In this situation, they don't call it a premium. Tammy's gonna be mad at me. They are not insurance, they're health sharing, okay? So I'm gonna be clear about that. But for comparisons, this is like a premium. He would pay about $4,500 a year in his LICA premium, but couple that with the very, very inexpensive cash pay pricing. He would save in 1 year over $11,000, not getting the same care, getting better care by just changing how you finance the system. So just to summarize, direct primary care, low cost, membership model of care, no billing hassles, this includes all your visits, all the diagnostics, all the in-house testing, procedures, telemedicine, I'm going faster than the monitor. Discount labs, discount meds, discount imaging, discount medications. But the real fundamental of this is direct primary care. Doctors being doctors. Which brings me back to my original question. What should the practice of medicine look like? Thank you very much.
We're going to be talking about self-funded insurance. And when you talk about insurance, when you talk about healthcare in general, there's several different important healthcare considerations that everyone has to look at. One is the individual and the employee. They're looking for coverage that is not going to have an ACA fine. They're looking for coverage. They want the best coverage that they can get. They're looking for what is it going to be their out-of-pocket cost. That's the total amount that you're paying between co-pays, deductibles, co-insurance, and can I keep my doctor? Next, you have the provider, because you have to have, you've got the individuals, the patients, and then you've got the provider. He's looking for a solid patient base that's going to bring in sufficient revenue so he can have an office, so he can pay for staff, equipment, and supplies. And most importantly, to be free from government oversight. That's that 800-pound gorilla that Dr. Savage was speaking about. And then finally, you've got the business. You've got the employer, who's one of the big components of this, you know, because a lot of people get their insurance through their employer. So these are the areas that we have to look at. So we're going to focus on the business or the employer. So the employer is going to be looking at what are their options for offering a qualified health plan. What's the cost going to be for the employer? What's the cost going to be for the employee? What do they have to contribute? What is the employee coverage going to be? You have to offer something that is going to make it attractive for future employees to want to work for you. And we have to look at the positives and negatives. So traditionally, for group health benefit options, traditionally, we've all know the fully insured. Those are your Blue Cross United plans. In this structure with a fully insured plan, the company, they pay a premium. They have a set premium that is designed at the beginning of the year. And they pay the set premium, and it's decided on the number of employees. And they look at the risk. And the insurance carrier, they assume all risk for claims. So if you have an employee that has a catastrophic illness or something like that, the employer is not at risk, the insurance company is. 17% of small employers choose this option. But you also now have self-insured plans, which these are ERISA-based plans. So self-insured equals self-funding equals employers taking on the risk of their employees' claim expenses. So they'll hear self-insured and self-funded back and forth. They mean the same thing. And a lot of people don't know this, but in 2015, 63% of all workers, regardless of employer size, were covered by a self-insured plan. Many employees are covered by self-insured plans and don't even know it. Because the benefits are so good, they don't know it. The employer is the owner of the plan. They pay all of the claims out of their operating budget, and claims are 100% funded by the employer. Okay. So in the traditional, aka fully insured, which we all know because of the cost of co-pays, deductibles, that is a misnomer, but the premium is paid to the insurance carrier. Okay, in 2015, for a single, this is what the employer has paid, for a single individual, premium was over $6,000. For a family, it was over $17,000 a year. Premium rates are fixed for a year based on the number of employees, and it goes up every single year. The policy must cover essential health benefits. Which drives up costs. Essential health benefits are those 10 items that the Affordable Care Act said that you must cover, which includes things like prescription drugs, maternity care, newborn care. There's 10 different items. They also have to pay a premium tax. When you have a fully insured plan, there is a premium tax. It's the highest cost, and there's no possibility of any money coming back. And I'll explain that in a minute. With the self-insured plan, the employer acts as its own insurer. Okay, the payment is based on actual incurred claims. Additional benefit cash is held in reserve, so they pay a certain amount of premium every month, and if the claims don't equal that, the employer holds on to their money. The employer designs the policy. They sit down, they determine amongst their employees, they look at cost, they decide what they want the policy to be, and they do not have to comply with essential health benefits, which greatly reduces the cost. The premium tax is eliminated with a self-funded plan. So we're seeing how the cost is lowered. You can purchase a stop loss insurance, which is another insurance that can be purchased as part of the plan that limits your claim risk. So if you have somebody who has a catastrophic event, your claim, your risk is going to be, you know, limited. There's potentially much lower costs with a high chance of premium return. I'll show you how that will work. So how does self-funding work? So we're looking at an illustration that's featuring 112 enrolled employees and expenses. So they had claim expense right here. They had claim expense of $690,000. So that's what the fully insured carrier paid out for claims, was $690,000. However, the premiums that the insurance company paid was $970,000. So where did that other money go? It went to the insurance company. You cannot, the employer cannot get that money back. So with a self-funded plan, so now we're looking at this box down here. We have, these are the administrative costs, which in this illustration runs about $30,000. Then we're looking at the stop loss, which runs about $130,000. Here is our $690,000 in expected claims. And what's this box up here? This is the $120,000 that the employer gets to keep. So they have, so their premiums that they actually paid was $850,000, $120,000 in savings in 1 year. So group health positives and negatives. With a traditional plan, the positives are you do have predictable premiums. The premiums stay the same month in, month out. There's no employer risk for large claims. The negatives are you have a limited plan design because most employers are going to pick the lowest plan that they possibly can with the highest employee contribution so that they can keep the costs down. They must include the state mandates. They have to pay a premium tax. There's no cash flow advantage, so if claims are lower, it doesn't matter. It's not, it's, there's no cash flow. No benefit for lower than expected claims. But with the self-insured, the positives are the claim risk is limited with stop-loss coverage. Cash flow, claims are not funded until they're paid. The advantage when claims are lower than expected. So if you expect your claims, if you're paying out a premium where you're expecting claims to be say $500,000 and they only come in at $200,000, the employer keeps that $300,000 difference. Okay, long-term lower costs. There are some negatives, and that's cash flow fluctuations in the early years. It's difficult when you're first starting this because you have to be able to develop your pool, your reserve pool, which is what pays your claims. And that takes time to develop. But once you get into it, it's good. And I've got an example here. But self-funding and direct primary care. So we're looking at that claims. That's the big if. The most important part of any self-funded plan is to control your claims. What is the best way to control claims? You use free market solutions and especially direct primary care, just as Dr. Savage just laid out. So with direct primary care, you lower the entry-level threshold for self-funding so startup is easier and less costly. And I'm going to hit that in just a second. Reduces unnecessary utilization of hospitals, ERs, and the specialists because you're keeping more in-house. Referrals to specialists and hospitals that deliver based on their already self-declared or declared cash pricing. You decrease lab, radiology, and ancillary testing. You improve chronic care treatment. Patients can actually get into their doctor for a much cheaper cost. And most DPC practices offer in-house testing, so you're not having to send people out to outpatient facilities, which are more expensive. So how does self-funding work? So we're going back to here. So we're looking at this expected claims pool right here. So if you already have your plan savings up here of $120,000 that we just spoke about, with DPC, you can expect to save on average at least another 30%. So we're talking $207,000 in savings. So a total here of $327,000 for these 112 people. So we'll go over a success story real quick. Palm Beach County Fire Rescue, they were established in 1984 with a merger of 8 fire control districts. There were approximately 400 employees. They started their self-funded plan with a seed money of $300,000. They had many challenges to start. The very first year, they had a twin set of preemies that were born, just about depleted their pool. But flash forward 32 years, they've been doing self-funded for 32 years now. Their family premium is less than $300 a year, and their rates have not raised in over 10 years. They have a phenomenal benefits package. They actually have, and this no fully insured plan offers this, they have stem cell storage at no cost. It's been proven that when you get on later in years, if you have a chronic condition, stem cells are the most effective way to add a cure. They continue to add benefits and grow reserves, and the reserves, 5 years ago, the reserves were to such a level that they were able to stop the stop-loss premium. So they saved more money there. So they struggled for a couple years, they had to make sacrifices, combining plans, but they did it and never looked back. So where do you begin? You want to plan at least 1 year in advance. Once you've made the decision, to go self-insured, you want to start planning 1 year out. There's a lot of pieces that need to be put in place, and it takes time. Self-funding is not something to be rushed into if you want to do it right and be successful. Next, you have to find an independent TPA, and this is so important. The employer hires a TPA, a third-party administrator. They're the ones who will actually process and adjudicate the claims, and they manage the plan. There's different types of TPAs. There's independent, ASO, which is like a Blue Cross, and there's hybrids, which is like your PPO network. If an insurance carrier is the TPA or owns the PPO network, the employer will have little to no control over their plan, and it will be difficult for the employer to work with a DPC provider. This is really important. PPOs actually have in their contracts with the employer that they cannot see their claims. They can't see their claims. So getting an independent TPA is extremely important. Next, you have to audit your risk data. And you try to look at your risk data from previous years of coverage. Not always is that possible. The TPA will help you with everything from plan development to purchasing stop loss to claim handling and administration. They are your partner in the entire process. That's why they are so important to get a good one. And lastly is develop your plan and combine with a DPC. You want to develop your plan based on the need and the cost, employee contribution. Include a network of free market providers and especially DPC. This is what bends that cost curve so you're saving money on your claims. Again, a good independent TPA will help you with this, but it's important that they are independent and not adverse to using free market solutions. So what is the answer to all of these issues for the individual, the provider, the business employer? The answer is self-insurance plus direct primary care. The employee receives good, affordable coverage. The provider is free from government oversight, and they can practice the way they were trained and satisfy patients. The business provides qualified benefits that satisfy employee needs at a cost they can afford. So where do you begin? You find a good independent TPA.
Please discuss the role of health saving accounts and why can't individual insurance premiums be tax deductible like employers enjoy? And health medical saving accounts are something that's been bandied about as they replace Obamacare, and I think it might work beautifully with direct physician care because it's basically a vehicle to fund your health care and you control that pot of money, and I'll let the let's let Chad speak to that.
Well, basically, the reason it's not is because the IRS didn't set it up that way. I'm just quite simply, and one of the big pushes by the incoming administration is to open that up so that you potentially can. I mean, nothing's passed yet, but that's the real encouragement, is that direct primary care may be able to be payable through HSAs, your premiums may be able to, there is huge potential. As of today, you can't do that, but that may be changing soon.
Steve, can I add something to that?
Sure, go ahead.
Well, you know, whoever asked that question, I'll pay a dollar afterwards, because in the back of the table there, there is a petition to our congressional delegation to expand health savings accounts. So I anticipated your question, and they should be expanded by increasing the yearly amount that can be deposited for each family member, funding usual medical care and medicinals at the person's discretion, being able to pay for direct care contracts with any physician or physicians of your choice, being able to fund a high deductible insurance policy for more expensive items that can be purchased across state lines. So if you could sign this, okay, sign, print your name, put in your zip code, and we will send it to our congressional delegation. We can probably get this done if we create enough signatures and pressure on our representatives and senators. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Could we just pass that up and down the road?
We certainly can.
Do we have a board or something?
Oh, and there are many copies back
here. There's Obamacare here. He's got
yeah, sure. Here.
There's a copy on the back table also.
There are four or five copies. So we can pass that around. Everybody signs it. Doesn't cost you anything, but it could benefit you a great deal. Thank you.
Put your contact information on there so we can do some follow-up so that we get a groundswell of people encouraging this type of action. The next question, do you expect continuation of hospitals to provide free services for anyone coming in the door with no
insurance coverage,
no ability to pay, or non-citizens? What that's referring to is the current practice. If you go into Zealand Hospital, there's a big sign there. Basically, if you're sick and you walk in there, they can't deny you service, even if you can't afford to pay for it. That's law. When people say people are dying without lack of service, that was a political move, because basically they're required to provide care. If you can get through the door, or people can drag you through the door, they have to provide service, whether you can pay or not. That may be part of why there's $50 aspirin. But so I'll leave that to the panelists. Do you expect hospitals to continue to provide free services for anyone coming in the door with no ability to pay or non-citizens?
I can answer that.
Sure, good.
As an emergency room doc for 22 years, we have my services here.
Talk up. Can you hear him back there?
That mic is working.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Okay. Talk louder.
So in the emergency department for 22 years, the hospitals are funded with Hill-Burton funds, and if we receive money in a hospital, we have to provide free services. So we will have to legally, according to the government, provide free services to people who have not any means or measures to pay for it. However, if you don't have a means, we can at that time enroll people in Medicaid. Medicaid always has been, before Obama, our backup system, our safety net. And we had millions of people being taken care of that had no ability to pay through Medicaid.
Thanks, Dr. Jindal.
Yeah, I think there's something really important to add to that. This is a hoax that is perpetrated by hospitals that say, look what we do for the community. And also, therefore, keeps their monopoly, okay? So there are certificate of need laws in the state of Michigan where hospitals will get no competition because, quote, they give free care. And it turns out to be about 2-3% of their budget. It's a nothing, okay? So and there's a law called EMTALA, Emergency Medical Treatment and Labor Act, passed about 10 years ago, that they have to do it. The way around it is to make sure that every individual in America has a health savings account that is funded, if they have no income, with a tax refundable tax credit. So this idea of taking care of the poor has been a way, you know what the average reimbursement for a CEO of a hospital is? Take a guess. $5 million. This is a gigantic hoax, folks. All right? And what we have to do is get everybody covered, so there's no such need for this. There goes the certificate of need, and we can have hospitals competing and new operations created to develop a competition and therefore improve care. Thank you.
And I just want to point out, one of the reasons that was portrayed for expanding Medicaid in the state of Michigan was to address this uncompensated care. And I want to highlight that if you're getting Medicaid coverage, a lot of the folks are not getting access to care. We were talking about the time rationing. Dr. Savage talked about it. If you're only getting 47 cents on the dollar from a Medicaid patient, you're getting a lot of time rationing associated with it. And the fact is that Medicaid patients see the ER three times as much as an uninsured person or as a traditional or private insurance person. So it was all actually set up, to kind of Dr. Fisher's point, to push more people into the hospital system and actually get additional revenue. So the way around that is by promoting direct primary care policies. Give people on Medicaid a real alternative that actually gets them access to physician, gets them better care, keeps them out of the hospital, and lowers overall medical costs. That's why I pushed for a DPCS-based pilot in the last budget cycle, and I was opposed by the Michigan Association of Health Plans and Michigan Hospital Association, and we got it through the Senate, but in leadership, they actually took it out and scrubbed it out of the budget. So we need to go off and highlight the importance of applying this direct primary care services principle, and at the end of today, we're going to talk about what you guys can all do to help. Please stick around to the end, because this is about evangelism right now. All the stuff that we're talking about today, we need you to carry to the streets for us.
Hey, Steve.
Go ahead,
Dr. Politicians generally don't know anything about health care, but there is one politician in this room. His wife is a pediatrician, and I've talked with this gentleman several times. Patrick knows as much about health care and all of his fallacies as Dave Chase does. If you go online, look up Dave Chase about the insurance heist, the health insurance heist. It's a great article and puts it in perspective. But Patrick really knows all the problems and faults that we have with our present healthcare system.
Thanks.
I'd like to add a point that when Obamacare was passed, one of the things were promised, if you passed it, is that people would use the emergency room less because they had this great healthcare card. The reality is they use the emergency room more, if I'm correct. And so basically, another one of the many lies of Obamacare, it would fill a large sheet. This question relates to the previous one. Can DPC contract directly with Medicaid patients?
Well, with Medicaid patients, but they're going to have to pay for it on their own. Medicaid does not allow for direct reimbursement of direct primary care services. As a matter of fact, the pilot that we had set up in Michigan meant the state of Michigan was going to pay for the DPCS coverage, the service costs, the monthly service costs. In the state of Washington, they did it as a pass-through. They'll reimburse the managed care provider, and then the managed care provider would subcontract out to a direct primary care service outfit as a subcontract. But Medicaid itself, under current CMS rules, will not allow for a direct reimbursement of DPCS. So that's something we need to have change, and actually it's some of the one of the items we're pushing in this new Trump administration to go off and change.
If I can add a couple of points, you know, it's interesting when we have these talks. People, I don't know if anybody's ever heard of concierge medicine. It's very expensive medical care. People want to do it. That's great, but that people get that confused with direct primary care. To talk about the Medicaid and the poor, our biggest area of growth in my practice is the working poor. For many people, we are their only access to medical care. Sadly, many people either avoid getting insurance altogether, which makes me pull my hair out, not because I like insurance, but because the Christian health sharing options sometimes are cheaper than the penalty. So you can actually get something instead of nothing, and when you merge it with things like us, you can get hospitalization, surgical coverage, unlimited primary care, discounts on everything for the cost of the penalty. So why would you accept the penalty? But anyway, actually, we see a lot of Medicaid patients who have such trouble accessing doctors that they can't get one. It doesn't matter if it's covered, if you can't get anybody who takes it or won't get you in to see them. And then a real quick comment on the ER issue too. You gotta have some reserve capacity in the system to take care of the acutely sick. Well, where do you wanna have that? And I'm not talking somebody who has a heart attack or a major car crash or something. That always, the right place for that is always an emergency department. But the problem is the time rationing is so severe in primary care now that a lot of people say, I can't get in to see my primary care doctor, so I'm going to the emergency department, like the poison ivy issue I mentioned. Well, the problem with that is that's the most expensive place to access care. You have a trauma team, crash carts, tons of nurses, all waiting around for a cold. If you're going to have reserve capacity, you have it with a doctor and a nurse. My staff is 1-to-1. We have one nurse, one doctor, kind of sounds like the way it used to be. Everybody says it's too complex, can't do that anymore. I was going to say BS, but the actual words. I'll just say the letters, BS. We're doing it, and we're giving our patients better care, and they can get in to see us and end up not going to the emergency department for those situations.
Chad is absolutely correct. The ER is overutilized, and the majority of our people with our health care plan at direct primary care are people who are low income. They sometimes are income low enough to qualify for Medicaid, and they actually come in to our facility because I'm sure with Chad also, they can't get into their Medicaid physician.
This next question, I think, relates to something Meg had helped me learn years ago. Do you expect primary care doctors in West Michigan to be more prevalent? And years ago, I learned from Meg that the small private practices were being driven out by the large medical establishments that were hiring up the doctors. And I think there's a physician from U of M area that had a great private practice that was going to start, and it got bought out the week before they opened by U of M Hospital. And so it's like agribusiness and the small family farm. They don't want the competition, so they buy them out. And so this question is, do you expect primary care doctors in West Michigan to become more prevalent?
I can answer that
here. Okay, I thought you would.
All right, can you guys hear me? This thing isn't working. I happen to be really optimistic on this, so I think we have seen a shift.
That was working.
All right. I'm even louder now. It's right behind me.
Yeah.
I'm really optimistic on this. I think we have seen a lot of physicians enter into big healthcare systems. Things have kind of stabilized a little bit in healthcare in terms of things like ICD-10, things we've had to kind of deal with regulation-wise. And we're actually seeing a shift outward from some of these employed physicians. So I'm in a private practice, Brookville Pediatrics. We're in Rockford in Wyoming. We have 12 physicians. And we're called weekly by physicians who are in an employed model, unhappy with the situation for themselves, looking to get out. And they're in a situation also where they're not happy with how much time they're not spending with their patients, how they're having to send them over to see a nurse practitioner or a PA, and they're not actually seeing their patients anymore. So I think we are seeing a shift the other way. So I'm actually pretty optimistic. I probably wasn't very optimistic a few years
ago. Not much at all.
And I'm actually seeing the shift the other way, and I think that's a really positive thing. So I think you're gonna see more small practices, physicians who are willing to take this up, especially this direct primary care model. There is not much on the west side of the state yet. I do think that once one or two doctors take it up, you're gonna see more doctors really realizing this works. And I think we're gonna see a lot of, if we can get a few employers on this side of the state to take this up, that's the really big thing. I mean, if an employer takes this up and does this with their employees, you're going to see other employers start to do this as well. So we're kind of in a little bit of a stalemate right now where physicians are not so sure about doing it because the employers don't really see the doctors there. But if we can come together, I think this is really going to take off.
You know, I think it's important to realize that Obamacare, the concept was if we could just eliminate these crazy doctors who charge so much, we'll have them all work for a big hospital or a big group, and therefore we'll have a continuum of care and we'll save a fortune. So that was one of the arguments, right? So what's happened? Turns out that all these doctors got bought out. The prices for their tests are much more expensive than what that took place in the hospital, because now the big hospitals add a facility fee. That's number one. Number two, since they passed the High Tech Act, and your doctor has her or his nose in the computer, spends 7 minutes with you, feels less, much less confident, therefore orders many more tests. That's point number two. Point number three, which I can't remember right now, is that this is just another complete failure of Obamacare, and we have to, and don't forget this, this is an administration that stood for little business, the small guy. And what have they done? They've destroyed 500,000 small businesses that delivered great service on an idea that didn't work. Thank you.
This one I think is for Teresa. How do employers find an independent TPA, and are there any in Michigan?
Well, actually, it's very difficult to find a good independent TPA.
Say what a TPA is.
Third-party administrator. The problem is that in Michigan, there right now, we know of two possibly that may be independent. One of it actually is in Grand Rapids. But we are working with another organization, a TPA out of Oklahoma City, that is actually in the process. They are a true independent TPA, and they are extremely, they've bought into the whole direct primary care, and it's called the Kempton Group, and they actually have their application in for licensure in Michigan right now. So we're waiting on them, and once they are through and that's complete, we will have a good independent TPA.
This is a question about direct primary care meds and pharmacy. Is insulin covered or available through DPC? Is there a different yearly rate for someone with pre-existing conditions such as diabetes? And what about mental health care? Probably going back to Lisa.
Well, insulin's actually kind of a bugger. There's not a lot of great options. Almost all insulins are name brand at this point in time. Here's a quick tip. If you guys got Walmart, who doesn't? They do have less expensive 70/30 and regular Humulin versions that are like $20-some a vial. It's not as good, okay? But it is a good option for people who are really struggling to afford it. What are the other aspects of the question? I'm sorry?
It was, is insulin covered or available? Is there a different yearly rate for someone with a pre-existing condition,
nope,
such as diabetes?
Simple answer, no.
And what about mental health care?
Well, you mean for the doctor? No, I'm kidding. I mean, we do what we can do. 20% of primary care is treatment of mental health issues. That's no different for us. You know, the difference is if you, first of all, for personal philosophy, I try to avoid drugs if we can, but when you need them, we get Prozac for 66 cents a month.
Wow.
I could add that, Steve.
Go ahead.
Add to this for a second. Would you, Chad is right, there's a large percentage of people that we see in our practices every day that have mental health. It's difficult sometimes to separate the physiological from the psychological problems because they both intermingle. But we manage, Chad and I manage a lot of people with psychological problems every day. You don't need a psychiatrist except on the real severe cases of suicidal or bipolar. And in those types of situations, we can always get medication to help that.
We're kind of down to the lightning round here. In a certain order, we're going to give everybody 1 minute to share with the audience what do you want them to take away from this meeting tonight, starting with Dr. Savage.
Well, thank you, everybody, for letting me come out. I would say the one point that I would make is I hope you got from my lecture that all the prices in medicine are a farce. You saw what we can get these things from. It's from the same distributors, the same suppliers. We use LabCorp to get that $3 CBC. We get the same suppliers as CVS and Rite Aid to get that 66 cents Prozac. And that's because the free market is involved. We got the bureaucrats out of the way. You should always reserve the right to fire me. That sounds like a weird thing to say, but it is a little stress for doctors when we compete against each other, but that's not all stress is bad. That's a you stress. That's a good stress. It encourages quality of care, innovation, and excellence.
Next, Teresa.
Sorry, who redirect those?
I have a cardiologist in my area. I have a cardiology group and an individual cardiologist who reads my echoes. She does echoes for $180.
Currently, hopefully this will change soon, but currently all employers with 50 employees or more must provide health insurance. And this is an impact on every one of you if you have a job. So if your employer is not self-funded, you can take this to your HR department and talk to them about it. Because if the company saves money on the health benefits, guess what? There's more money to give you a high salary. There's more money to give you higher benefits, better benefits. So it benefits you all the way around. So I really want to encourage you, talk to your HR department about self-funded insurance. And and find those DPC providers. Encourage providers to go that route. Even if your provider is not currently direct primary care, that is an option for them. You combine that with your employer-funded insurance, and you've got complete coverage at the best possible cost.
Steve, can I take my minute?
Take your minute.
I'd just like to add to that also. Teresa has presented to you the business side of the direct primary care. And we know that it's extremely difficult for doctors to step into direct primary care. You have to have a very rich wife or a second job or something like that to help you along, right? But we have a health share plan that people in any part of the state can step into the health share plan at a separate location, and we can help him set up everything that he needs to be able to completely take care of this whole direct primary care, in addition to his regular insurances that he's taking at the present time. So if you have a doctor that you think would be interested in that, just have him give us a call. We'll share the information with him and really explain to him how simple it is to set things up.
Why don't you have Dr. Fisher go next?
Yeah, this catastrophe in healthcare, which is consuming 20% of GDP of this country, which causes us not to educate our children adequately, started in 1965 with Medicare and Medicaid. It was actually written in 2 days by the head of the budget committee, and it was a consolidation of different plans floating around Congress for 15, 20 years. So the way to get out of this, folks, is to say to your representative and senator, I've put into Medicare all my life, okay? This is my money that you have spent. There's no fund. It hasn't grown over time like it should be. I want to manage my own health care. I don't want people from Washington telling my doctor how to take care of me. I want a yearly check into my health savings account, and I will take care of myself. So that's what I'm asking you to do. Tell your congressman, this is crazy. Okay? Thank you very much.
Okay, go ahead, use that.
Use this one right here?
Yeah.
I get the second to last word. This is the best. I guess my takeaway here is, I don't know about you guys, last Wednesday morning I woke up and I was so happy. Mm-hmm. I was happy the whole day. I had Permigran the whole day. I love the idea of a new start, being able to have new ideas. It really, really made my day, and it's made my week. But I don't know if you've noticed, but half the country doesn't agree with me. And there are some kind of ridiculous protesting going on, but there are some people with legitimate concerns. So there are people who, they are gonna lose their insurance. They are worried about that. People who are on a Medicaid expansion, people who have large subsidies, they're gonna lose it, and they're legitimately worried. We have their advocacy groups that are out there, and they're just making terrible statements, accusing all these Medicaid patients are not going to have any care. We're going to throw them out of the streets. All the disabled people aren't going to have any care, and it's horrible. It's frustrating. On one hand, if you're a person who's been following healthcare for a while, you knew this day was coming, right? You knew this was designed so that the people that wrote it were going to be out the door, and then the rest of us are going to be left holding the bag, and trying to figure out what are we going to do with this, right? So it's frustrating from that standpoint.
But what is the most frustrating thing about the argument is I haven't heard a single person on social media, and I do a lot of social media, saying, oh my word, Trump is in office. How am I going to pay for my car insurance? You know, oh my word, Trump is in the office. He's going to take away my Netflix subscription. And why haven't we heard that, right? It's because that's stuff that we own. That's ours. We choose to buy it if we want for entertainment, or we have it as our, it's our own. If you lose your job, you don't lose your car insurance. These are things that are ours. They have nothing to do with whoever is president. And that's the conversation I have with these people that are legitimately concerned, is we have to do better. We need to have something sustainable that's going to take care of everyone, especially our most needy, that isn't dependent on who's in the White House. And we have an election every 2 years, and we're going to have a new president in 8 years, and I want to make sure that we have something that is sustainable, that it doesn't matter if it's Rand Paul, who's president in 8 years, it's going to be a great system. And so that's what we, when we're talking with people, this is what we're talking about. We want something that is sustainable. It starts in things like this, where what we're talking about here, direct primary care, that started in earnest under Obama, under President Obama. It's going to flourish under President Trump. You know, and that's what's really exciting. And it doesn't even really matter what they're doing. What we're doing here, it's very different. And I love that we're kind of getting all of those bureaucrats and all of the you know, insurance lobbyists out of the picture, and it's just you and your doctor. For employers, it's you going, okay, we're going to contract directly with that doctor and not be giving money to an insurance company to then give it to the doctor. It's really exciting stuff, so that's my takeaway.
Thanks, Ray. Pat Colbeck.
Thank you very much. I don't mind if I stand up for this, but I wanted to ask you guys, where else have you heard about these free market healthcare options? Have you heard about this on the TV? Heard about this on the nightly news? Where have you heard about Christian Medishare? Where have you heard about self-funded insurance? Where have you heard about direct primary care? You haven't. There's a reason. I don't know if you guys noticed this, but my district's over on the other side of the state. I'm the last red district, red splotch in Wayne County, which is the home of Detroit. I came all the way out here because we are in full free market evangelism mode. This is important on so many levels. That first slide I talked about kind of talks about it from a financial perspective, but there's a human perspective, as we talked about tonight as well, that's very important. But I'm asking each and every one of you in this forum tonight to do is pick up this sheet afterwards. And there's a little sheet that says, like what you heard today, here's some action steps and what you can go off and do. Talk to your employers. Make sure that they understand about options like Christian Medishare or self-funded insurance plans. Make sure they understand about what's going on with direct primary care. When you're going into your doctor, let them know about direct primary care services as an option for their business practice. What we need to start doing is start generating demand, and then if we start generating demand, as we were talking about before, we're going to start generating supply with direct primary care docs. But the only way that's going to happen is if you go off and join us and become free market healthcare evangelists. So please pick this up. There's some other handouts there as well that talk about free market healthcare in general. I've written quite a few editorials on it, and there's ways to get in contact with our office. So if you find an employer interested in it, have them contact our office. If you find a doctor interested, have them contact our office. We need your help to get the message out. Thank you very much tonight, and thanks, Steve, for